I started drawing very early in life. I was about 3 years old. My father would say, "Morton, go down and get me the newspaper." And I'd bring it up, get in bed with him. He put his arm around me, and he'd read me the comics. And that's how I got it. So I'd looked up at my father, he'd laugh, and tears would come down his cheeks. And I never looked at the comics. I looked at him, and I said, "What a great thing to do to people, make them laugh." So I started drawing cartoons when I was 3 years old. And my father had to travel all the time, so he couldn't read me the comics every day. So I went to next door neighbor and said, she was training to be a teacher. And I said, "Could you teach me to read?" She says, "Sure." So I was reading books when I was 3 years old. I was checking 3 books a week out of the library. And I started doing political cartoons, because we were in the Depression then. And I did a lot of Depression gags, people looking for work and looking for money and stuff. And when I started kindergarten, I was so far ahead of everybody, sometimes they would put me in the closet because I was embarrassing the other kids, because I knew how to read, I was drawing, and the school newspaper was publishing my cartoons when I was 5, 6 years old. And I started drawing and painting, doing cartoons for national publications. By the time I was 12 years old, I dropped out of school and started selling gag cartoons, you know, one panel cartoons. I sold about 100 of them in a year. And I was written up in national newspapers and magazines by pictures at the drawing board. And I was an amazing little boy. I didn't realize I was just doing what I enjoyed doing. And so I dropped out of school for a year, and I sold over 100 cartoons in that year. And then I happened to read an article by somebody that said, drawing cartoons are not just the drawing, it's the writing that really is important. That's what people laugh at. They don't laugh at the cartoons. I said, "Oh boy." I said, "I got to learn how to write." So I went back into school, and then I enrolled in all the writing courses. And so I was, the teacher thought I was an exceptional student. He said, "How would you like to come home and have dinner with me and my wife?" And I said, "Sure." So I go, and all the way through dinner, we talked about books and articles and so forth, and writing, you know. And so he pulled his chair up afterwards, right in front of me. He says, "Well, I guess you'd like to write the great American novel." And I said, "No." He said, "No?" I said, "No, I want to write the great American comic strip." He said, "Comic strip?" He got up, walked away. And that was the way I had to fight my way for attention all the time, is that people consider comic strips just sort of a plaything, you know. And books, writing, really important thing. Well, anyway, I learned how to write, and I wrote a lot of articles and things myself. And it was just a form of education for me. I educated myself. And I was an outstanding student all the way through school. Except all the teachers used to push me over to one side, made me face the blackboard in the rear so I wouldn't disturb the other kids. Mullins was my father's favorite strip. And he'd laugh until the tears came down out of his eyes. And of course, Dick Tracy, a lot of the comic strips in those days were story strips. Prince Valiant, for instance, and Tarzan. So those are some of the famous comedy strips. But little by little, those strips disappeared because people traveled a lot. This was a very busy country. And if they traveled a lot and didn't read the comics, when they got back, they didn't know what was going on in the comedy strips. So they stopped reading the story strips. And they wanted a daily laugh. And that's where I fit in. I developed Beetle Bailey for the Saturday Evening Post. That was the big magazine here at the time. And the editor loved my work. And I was doing college cartoons because I was going to college. That was where I got my humor. And so one day he said, "That's a funny looking character with a hat over his eyes. Why don't you feature him? And we'll run him as a feature." I said, "Okay." So I began using him. And I needed a name for him. And in my fraternity, back in those days, there was a lot of drinking. And this friend of mine was at a local pub, and he got drunk and he couldn't walk. So he hired a car to bring him back to the fraternity house. And then when he got out, he couldn't walk up to the front door to come in. So he crawled up the front lawn, and we were all of us big, you know, little group were sitting there laughing at him. So, look, he looks just like a what was it? What was he called? Anyway, they said he looked just like a cricket or something like that. I forget back then. So the character I created was, I called him by that name. And I was doing college cartoons. So, but the problem was that back in those days, only about 5% of the people went to college. So a lot of people didn't relate to it. So, anyway, I was the top-selling magazine cartoonist that year, and I was about 15 years old. And then I got married, and my wife said, "You're the top seller in this country, and you only made $8,000 in a whole year?" I said, "Yeah." She says, "You're in the wrong business." I said, "Really?" She says, "Yeah, the comics are cartoonists get rich. You can't get rich on $8,000 a year." So that night I sat down and created a comic strip that was all about college, using my character. And I took it to King Features the next day, and they bought it. That was how quick it was. So success has come to me very easily. And so they tried to sell it as a college comic strip, and it didn't sell. So they said, "You're going to have to change it." And I said, "Well, to what?" They said, "Well, everybody's going into the army now. You know, the war's going on. Put him in the army." And I resisted it because I said, after World War II, after World War I, I guess it was, all the cartoonists were out of work. Nobody was buying army cartoons anymore. But we're getting into another war, and I think people are going to be interested in it. So I put him in the army, and boom, it took off. And within 6 months, I was in 1,000 papers.
Oh.
And making a lot of money.
Yeah.
And it was always my ambition to make some money, because my father, even though he was an architect, he built whole cities. He specialized in churches, but he would only charge for $5,000 to build a church. And he did a lot of the work himself, and I went with him on a lot of his excursions. And I worked with him. He didn't pay me. I've been doing Beetle for 70 years, yeah. I guess the minute I put him in the Army, then it took off. And I began selling over 1,000 papers, 1,500 papers. And so that was it. I was stuck with that now. And I started making pretty good money. And but I never made as much as I wanted to. I wanted to be rich. So after a few years, when the strip was really selling well and making money, King Features gave me my contract to sign for the next 20 years. And the contract said that they had created Beetle Bailey and hired me to draw it. And if I died, I had three of my sons working with me on it, writing and drawing and everything. And they said, if you die or quit, we own it. And I said, I'm not going to sign that contract. It's a lie. I said, I created Beetle Bailey for the Saturday Evening Post. You didn't have nothing to do with it. I'm not gonna sign that contract. So I went for a whole year without a contract. And they were afraid I was gonna go over to another syndicate. And they finally came to me and said, okay, what do you want? I said, $1 million. And they said, okay. So I got $1 million to sign the contract. And I thought, I did it! Because I skipped all of my years of my other jobs where I was screwed out of of any money. For instance, I worked in the shipping department for Hallmark Cards. And I heard that the art department upstairs was looking for an artist. So I set up some of my drawings, and the vice president of Hallmark said, come on up, I want to talk with you. So I went upstairs, and he had a little group there to interview me. He says, how do you like our cards? I says, they stink. He said, what? I said, yeah, you don't have anything for bed. He said, you got pretty little cards, you got flowers, you got houses, you got trees. And I says, that doesn't appeal to men. He said, you're hired. So I started doing funny cards. Nobody was doing funny cards at that time. You know, like, well, almost all the cards today are humorous. And when I found out that Hallmark, you know, really liked my humorous cards, I came up from the shipping department and started working upstairs. And they put me in charge of the writing group. And so but they only paid me $25 a week. So they didn't compensate for the work I did for them. And so finally I decided to go to New York, and I went to work for a publishing company. When I was in college, I was doing this school magazine called Show Me Magazine, and I made it a humor magazine, and it was quoted all over the country to other colleges would pick up our work and use it in their magazines. Humor, I guess, was a big thing, you know, just nobody had been doing it. And but they only paid me $25 a week. So when I got to New York and went to work for Dell Publishing Company, they said, we have a humor magazine we'd like for you to edit, and we'll pay you $45 a week. Well, that was a doubling of what I was making. So I said, okay. So I went to work for them. They gave me two other magazines to edit, and they hired an assistant or a co-editor, you might say, and a secretary. And when they found out I could type, and they watched me work, and they said, we can't pay you $45 a week. We can only pay you $40. And we think we'd like for you to take over the whole job. We fired your secretary, we fired your assistant. You're the editor. And I thought, boy, here I am getting screwed again. So I got busy yesterday and wrote a whole bunch of gags. So in 2 days, I've got 13 gags. And I'll do some more today or tomorrow. And I'm supposed to attend the gag conference with 20 gags. And four Sundays. Then two of my sons work with me. They write 20. And so we have 60 gags that we can choose from. So we're very selective, and we end up with good material, and I think we're the funniest strip going, and it really works out well for us. You know, it's like, are you going to stop breathing? You going to stop laughing? You going to stop making money? This is the perfect situation for me. I really enjoy what I'm doing. I enjoy working, thinking of gags. In fact, I try to be funny wherever I am. I go to the grocery store, and my wife goes out shopping somewhere in the store, and I start looking around for her, can't find her. The manager of the store says, what are you looking for? Can I help you? I said, yeah. What aisle do you keep wives in? And I just joke with everybody I run into, and they like me at the grocery store. Because I can make a joke out of anything. And I do it all the time. It drives people nuts.
I see trees of green, red roses too. I see them bloom for me and you. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world.